Okay, I got to tell you an interesting background story. I was with a group of our staff. We're developing the materials that you're watching right now. And on the week restoration, which is what we talked about this past weekend, restoration, I said, I don't remember even reading the word restoration in the Bible. And a couple in the group go, no, it's in there. And they started getting on their phones and, you know, looking at their Bible apps to type in the word restoration. And I learned something I'd never known before. Thank you, Megan, for teaching me this. It was the Greek word for restoration is katartizo. Katartizo. A guy from across the table who knows no Greek said, wait a minute, that's where we get the English word cathartic. Exactly right, Zach. Exactly right. Cathartic is when there is a, like something that is a cleansing or a washing, a flushing out. So I'm going to read several Bible passages where this word katharizo is used. And I want for you to identify which of these English words is actually the Greek word katharizo, which is translated restored. Here we go. And going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and he called them. Okay, which word in that passage is katharizo? Which word? The word mending. Their nets had been broken from use through the night, and as they mended them, that was the Greek word katharizo, which we translated as cathartic or cleansing. It's not exactly the same, but you get the picture. It's putting something back together. Okay, let's try another one. A disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone, when he is fully trained, will be like his teacher. Did you get it? Trained. It's not exactly like our word cathartic, but it is this idea of being built up. So you mend a net to make it usable. You train a disciple to make him or her usable. Okay, here we go. 1 Corinthians 1:10. I appeal to you, brothers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree and that there be no division among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same judgment. What word is it? You got it? It's the word united. Again, mending the net, pulling them together, tightening them up, make it usable. Discipling, you training a disciple to be usable and whole. And unity of the whole body is when you bring the body together. You mend the fences. Let's try this one. This one should be obvious. If anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourselves, lest you too be tempted. Well, obviously, the word restore is the word restore. But what I want to point out is who does the restoring? It's people around you, the community. Maybe someone in this room right now does the restoring for you. One last one. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. The point of this last passage is that though people around us can restore us, our ultimate restoration will even be beyond this life when the God of all glory in Christ, new bodies to be restored, new souls to be stored, new spirits to be restored. So here's a question. How do we see restoration defined in the Bible versus how we see it played out in our culture? When we think of restoration, we often think of a home, a car, or a marriage. You can like flip a home, you're restoring it, or a car is old, you sand it down, you repaint it, rebuild the chassis, or even a marriage can be restored after it seems to be breaking apart. But there are other areas, such as our finances, sometimes need to be restored. Our physical health, our faith need to be restored. So here's a question. Have you ever experienced restoration in one of those areas? And if you have, would you be willing to share what it was like and what brought positive, healthy restoration to you? Okay, I want us to, again, reread the story from the weekend. It's about a demonized guy in Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 20. And here's what I want you to do. As you read the story as a group, just take a mental note or maybe a piece of paper or type it into your phone. What are some lessons that this passage teaches you about restoration? It could be something that Jesus did, could be something that the man did, it could be something that the people around him did, either positive or negative. What do you learn about restoration? Because remember, you are part of the restoration of those around you. Go. there are many different areas of restoration in our lives. I'm gonna put up 12 areas that maybe you need restoration in. They're gonna come up on the screen. And I want you to identify one of these areas that maybe you would like to experience a little bit more restoration. Maybe you're partway there, maybe you're a lot there, or maybe you're way far from being restored. Share with the group one, maybe two areas where you need to take one or two steps toward restoration. sometimes restoration is like a new paint job. You know, you get an old car and you sand it down. You just put a little paint on it. Sometimes restoration is you got to rebuild the car from the chassis on up. I think all of us in our lives have areas that need a paint job. And if we're to be honest, we probably all have areas where we need a new chassis. But wherever you are, whatever you identified in the last question, here's the challenge. And it would be good to brainstorm ideas in the next few minutes. What could you do this week in 30 minutes that would be a step in the right direction for restoration? Maybe it's just making a phone call. Maybe it's scheduling an appointment. Maybe it's going on a walk. Or maybe it's a conversation with someone important to you, about you. Whatever it is, all of us can do one thing this week within 30 minutes to take one small step toward restoration. Thank you.